Hello everybody, welcome to part 5 and 6. This is Jason Beer and we're picking up on day 2 of Jarnail Singh's testimony about the Horizon scandal. And he is meant to be the lead head of prosecutions, is Mr. Singh, but he really isn't, or is he? He didn't even know himself. Anyway, let's get on with it.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Mr. Singh.
Good morning.
Good morning. Can we pick up where we left off yesterday, which was examining issues in the general sense on the process and the procedure for prosecuting suspected offenders? Did you ever advise the post office to pursue a prosecution to act as a deterrent to other sub-postmasters from committing crimes?
How do you mean? Sorry, can you flash it out a little bit so I can? No.
Putting it another way, was the aim of deterring other potential offenders a relevant consideration in deciding whether to prosecute a sub-postmaster?
I don't think so.
Right, already, we're straight into it. It's been a bit more combative. He's probably spoken to his solicitor the night before and this morning. Not implying that they stayed the night. at all. But what's obvious here is his demeanour is slightly different. He's clearly been told to hang back a bit, but he instantly forgets. Jarnail Singh's not a very bright man. He might have listened to the solicitor, but he forgets very quickly because he asks for the question to be asked in a different way, but still answers the question. But undeterred, Jason Beer asks the question in a different way just to make sure we get a clear beginning to the day so we know we're going to lead Jarnail Singh down some more cul-de-sacs for him to have to try and fish himself out of.
Under conclusion, paragraph 28, you say, in my opinion, because of the above evidence and matters, there's sufficient evidence to provide a realistic prospect of conviction of Mrs. Gourlay. In my opinion, it is in the public interest to prosecute Mrs. Gourlay because of breach of trust and the large amount of loss. And then prosecution and conviction will act as a deterrent to others. And Mrs. Gourlay, in her interview, is implicitly attempting to blame innocent parties. So it's a part of the sentence there which says prosecution and conviction will act as a deterrent to others. That tends to suggest that in deciding whether to prosecute or not, you did take into account the possible deterrent effect of a prosecution and perhaps conviction upon others. Would you agree?
Firstly, it's such a long time ago. I don't know the full details. I would have...
He's constantly breathing out. Why is he not deflated yet? He's like a Lilo.
So the solicitor is has said. Sorry, sir. You won't be able to hear because the hold on. Mr. Singh's solicitor has just said, "I'm sorry. I don't think this document was provided before." I'll check whether that's so. And if Mr. Singh needs any time at all to read it, he should have it.
I agree.
Thank you.
Do you need time to read this document?
Have you got quite a bit of papers from you?
I'm sorry.
Have you got quite a bit of papers to go up the background to it? So can I have as much as information you've got?
I can certainly research that and come back to you later in the day or when you come back next year. If that would assist, I don't know at the moment whether this was a document that was provided or not. I can just check, however.
The irony. Is anyone getting the irony?
Yes, it was part of the batch of documents that was provided last week. It was tabby 92. So you have had it before. I'll move on. Were cautions an available outcome that can come down?
No, that is a death stare, that ain't it.
Sorry?
Were cautions an available outcome?
Yes, I think yesterday we discussed it, yeah.
There was trying to buy time for no reason other than to waste time in the inquiry. And it's backfired. It's juice and beer. Of course it's prepared and sent everything. Of course all the information has been divulged of what's going to be brought up.
Was there a statutory basis for the post office issuing cautions to suspected offenders?
I'm sorry, I don't understand. I mean, the normal... What do you mean statutory? It's something that we've considered, yes. I mean, after the evidence... The next bit is whether there's an alternative way of dealing with it.
He's not very bright, is he? I don't like to keep interrupting, because I know from when I did part one and part two of the video, it annoyed the viewer. But what you're seeing now is more input from the solicitor, but Jarnail is just not bright enough to know that if you're going to lie and trying to deceive and to be obstructive, is remembering to say, I don't understand. And I don't know. But then he's still answering the question in a roundabout way. It gets better.
Thank you. Can I ask you some questions about the duties of a prosecutor in relation to an expert witness? Do you agree that a prosecutor intending to rely on expert evidence in criminal proceedings was under the following duties? Firstly, to satisfy themselves as to the expert's relevant qualifications and expertise.
Come on, are you buffering or what?
Oh, sorry, you finished. Yes, yeah. Are you going to read the? I think you're going to read the whole thing, or are you?
Well, I could read out six things, and then you'd have to remember them.
Oh, okay.
And say which of them you agreed with, which you didn't. It might be best if I did them one by one.
One by, sorry, yes.
So that's the first one.
Can you say it again? Sorry.
Do you agree that a prosecutor was under a duty, if they intended to rely on expert evidence, to satisfy themselves as to the expert's relevant qualifications and experience?
Yes, yes.
Secondly, a prosecutor was required to satisfy themselves that the expert had been appropriately instructed, including by the provision of a written and detailed letter or email of instruction or terms of reference?
Yes, yes.
Thirdly, the prosecutor was under a duty to provide the expert within those instructions as to what it is that his or her opinion was sought about and should set out the issues or questions that they were expecting the expert to answer.
Generally, yes.
Fourthly, they were under a duty to provide explicit guidance as to what the expert was being asked to do and what material they were being asked to consider in order to undertake that task.
Yes, yes.
Fifthly, a prosecutor was under a duty to set out the material upon which reliance had been placed in the prosecution and which of that material may be relevant to the questions which the expert was being expected to answer.
Yes.
And sixthly, a prosecutor was under a duty to inform the expert as to the expert's relevant duties.
Yes.
We're going to come back to that big topic in a moment, whether you treated Mr. Jenkins as an expert
or
not.
Yep. Yes.
Jason B has just gone through about 15 minutes of making sure Jarnail Singh knew what an expert was and that it wasn't just a box-ticking exercise, that they had to make sure the expert really was an expert and what was being asked of them when they were being given evidence in court. I've just saved you 20 minutes of your life.
Embarking on the detailed evidence, can we agree on the following? Firstly, in the case of Seema Misra, no witness statement relied upon by the post office from Mr. Jenkins included any of the necessary inclusions required by the common law and the criminal procedure rules that I've just listed.
What's happened here is, he's just said yes, he understands what an expert is. He understands that an expert can't just show up to court and start sprouting off words. They have to make sure that what they're being asked of is also backed up with expert and credible accreditations in their expertise and experience. It's really important that an expert can be really designated as an expert. Someone can't just show up with a lanyard with a label stuck to it saying, I am an expert. Jarnail Singh said, yes, 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 yes. But they didn't say it that quick at all. It took 20 minutes. But this long pause here is a, oh. Yes, Jenkins was not an expert because none of what I've just agreed to as what is designated as an expert can be affixed to Mr. Jenkins because he was not an expert. He's led himself into a cul-de-sac.
No, because he didn't come in as an expert in the sense of an expert. He was an expert who was experienced in the system in itself because it's such a specialist system. And he assisting the prosecution, the defence and the court into understanding how the system worked or the operation of the system. I think that's how, why and how he came into advising. He came in as somebody who knew the system well.
Where is the fact that you met Mr. Jenkins in consultation with counsel?
I haven't taken any papers with me from the post office when I left. Everything's there.
No, hold on, no, I haven't asked the question yet.
Well, that's where you're coming. Well, okay, ask the question.
Just wait and see.
Okay, all right. Yeah.
Is the fact that you were attending a consultation or conference with counsel with Mr. Jenkins a couple of weeks before trial any indication that, in fact, you treated him as an expert witness? Because that's what one might do with an expert witness. Rather than a witness of fact, pretty unusual to sit down with prosecution counsel and chat through a witness of fact's evidence, isn't it?
I can't really tell you how these came about. I think certainly counsel asked for a conference. And it was such a long time ago, I didn't actually put it in my witness statement. And I think you provided further papers. And I think Mr. Jenkins, it was nice to, you know, nice to meet you and all the rest of it. Then I started remembering there was a conference. As to how that came about or why, what the circumstances were, I couldn't tell you. But certainly, we got a very experienced counsel who's been dealing with not just the post office cases, but wide experience of the prosecution for the CPS. He would have been well aware, and he would have made me well aware as to what I needed to do, as well as his duties. And I think he must have either the specifics of him being, his duties, my duties. We would have done that. But
I think it's right that there's no documentary record to which you can point that confirms that Mr. Jenkins understood, to your understanding, any relevant expert duties that he owed to the court. Is that? And then at the end, you say, however, this was an unusual case in that he was not regarded by the prosecution as an expert witness. but from recollection, went on to be treated as an expert by the court. In both of those paragraphs, you say that initially you did not treat him as an expert witness. Agreed?
Yes.
And in both of those paragraphs, you say that he, Mr. Jenkins, was treated by the court as an expert. Agreed?
Well, that's what I say.
Yes.
Yes.
And so, if you initially did not consider him to be acting as an expert, it follows, doesn't it, that there came a stage when you did consider him to be an expert. Agreed?
Not by... It's difficult because I think you're... It's very easy to play with words, but in the practice...
Is that what you think I'm doing?
Well, no.
Let me think
quietly to myself. I was thinking loud. Maybe it's not the place to think loud. Let me put it differently to you then.
Just so you can refocus on the question.
Yes.
In two paragraphs in your witness statement,
yes,
you said initially, I did not consider him to be acting as an expert, ...
Yeah.
And my question is, does it follow that later, i.e. after the initial bit had finished, you did consider him to be an expert?
Only as an expert in the Horizon system, because we did not have anybody else who had that specialist experience into the operation of it, the workings of it, and also even to analyse the transaction logs. And I think overall, in the scheme of things, in the case itself, he and...
I've got to cut in, because otherwise this is just going to cut into your time as much of the time. Don't forget, I've already had to watch this once and I'm having to do it again. What's just happened there, and what Jason Beer is saying, is that eventually you began to treat him as an expert, but without having to do all the work that he should have done, he didn't do any of that work to make sure that he was an actual expert. It was an expert that wasn't an expert, and he had no qualifications as an expert, and the court was allowed to be under the illusion that Gareth Jenkins was an expert when he was not. He was just some staffer, for all we know, from Fujitsu.
Was Mr. Jenkins made aware of the change in status that he had enjoyed?
How do you mean?
At one moment he's a witness of fact in the person who's calling him as a witness, and then the court is treating him as an expert.
Well,
was he informed of his change of status?
He basically was treated as if somebody who knew the system well, because that's more or less what the court issue in the case was. And I think as you would be aware, the judge actually said to the defense expert and Mr. Jenkins to have as much meeting, as much time as possible, with view to narrowing the issues to a point where there was actually a joint report, which both these gentlemen agreed to.
And is that normal in your experience for the court to order two parties to meet, one of whom is an expert and the other who is a lay witness of fact, and to produce a statement of agreement and disagreement, or a joint report?
Well, I've just said, I think it's we've been, for the last few minutes, I've told you this is the first experience in the post office cases I've ever had. And I think I was very much relying on, our barrister, basically saying, no, we can't use him. I mean, if he said to me right from the outset, Jarnail, we can't use him, then I would have stopped at that moment and try to find an expert outside, you know, who was a basically a professional expert, you know, who gave evidence in court. But this was the only person that we were who was put forward who knew the system very well, because this was a very, very specialist system. Only person who could actually not only assist the court, but actually went on to assist the defence expert.
Jarnail Singh couldn't get an expert. He called for Jitsu, or whatever. I've narrowed down, as you can see on the screen on the far left. They were an hour into it. He then contacted Fujitsu and said, look, I need somebody in court who can be an expert. Fujitsu, I've just sent some randomer, really, so he'll do. You go. Jarnail Singh has not done any, clearly not done any decent checks or anything into the expertise of Mr. Jenkins, and led the barrister into thinking that Jenkins was an expert and did no work at all in making sure that he was, that Mr. Jenkins was an expert. There you are. That's the last, another easy 20 to 30 minutes saved.
Well, yeah.
And was it from that moment, from when the judge gave directions as to the service of expert reports and the meeting of experts, that you treated Mr. Jenkins as an expert?
Well, we couldn't find any experts from the outer world who knew the system. I did look. I
don't know, my question, and I would really appreciate it. I'd appreciate it if you'd focus on my question rather than talking about other stuff.
Okay, fine. Okay.
Was it from the moment that the judge directed a timetable for the service of expert reports and that the expert should meet and produce a statement of areas of agreement and disagreement, that you treated Mr. Jenkins as an expert?
No.
So despite the court treating him as an expert,
no,
you did not?
At that time, I'm talking about the... maybe at cross purposes. The time and the dates I'm talking about, Mr. Jenkins didn't exist. I didn't know Mr. Jenkins.
So, okay, let's talk about the thing I'm talking about.
Okay.
When the court directed a timetable for the production of expert reports and directed that the expert should meet to produce statements of agreement and disagreement, from that moment on, did you treat Mr. Jenkins as an expert?
What date are we talking about? When are you? Because there's a date where they...
Autumn 2009.
I think that they wanted the experts, but we didn't have an expert at that time.
When the court issued, we're going to come to them later. I'm just asking you on this issue at the moment. We're going to come and look at all of these documents in a moment.
Yeah.
When in autumn 2009, the court issued directions that mentioned experts on each side, after that point, did you treat Mr. Jenkins as an expert?
No. Because
why not?
Jenkins wasn't there. Mr. Jenkins only came back around about February time.
Okay. So.
And, great pause there. That's a look to his solicitor. And this weird smile. He thinks he's getting somewhere, but he didn't.
Expert.
The thing, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but you just told me in one part of a very long answer that you were looking for an expert to deal with the issues arising from Horizon. You told me that you were unable to find such a person, and therefore Mr. Jenkins was introduced to you. What better evidence do I need for the fact that Mr. Jenkins was an expert than that which you just said?
Well, sir, I understand that, but then
Well, then, if you understand it, will you concentrate on Mr. Beer's questions and answer them a bit more succinctly, please?
So it's very difficult to work something in my head as quickly as Mr. Beer can, because I'm at an age and I've been out of practice such a long time to look at what it
together. Take a breath before you answer. Think about your answer.
I will, sir.
And then answer.
Is there any way I can have pen and paper and I can sort of do that because I can't. Well,
let him have some. Let's have a morning break and let Mr. Singh have some paper and pen to prepare himself.
That's very kind, sir. That's great. I'm very grateful. Thank you.
Sir, can we say 25 past, please?
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Even the judge is getting annoyed with Singh. Parts 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Jarnail Singh has not needed a piece of paper and a pencil. And to cut out the rest of wondering what's going to happen, no, he doesn't even use it once he's got it. Nothing changes. It was just an excuse because Jarnail probably just wanted to speak to his solicitor. Again.
Good morning, sir. Can you continue to see and hear us?
Yes, thank you, yes.
Please say Mr. Singh has now got both a pen and...
Thank you very much.
Paper. Thank you. Can we turn, please, to your witness statement at page 25, please?
The pen has replaced his glasses to fiddle with.
You can't say...
The language that you used is suggestive of you viewing Mr. Jenkins as an expert witness.
It's clumsy.
Just focus on the question. You agree that the language that you used in this email is suggestive of you viewing Mr. Jenkins as an expert witness?
The meaning isn't in that sense that he's instructed, isn't it?
He's in another cul-de-sac.
This is an email from you to Hugh Flemington and others, dated the 1st of July 2013. With the subject of discuss of defect in horizon in court, Seema Misra and Lee Castleton. Yes?
Yes.
And then if we scroll down, please, in your email, we instructed our own expert, Gareth Jenkins from Fujitsu. If you did not instruct Mr. Jenkins as an expert, why did you say we instructed Mr. Jenkins as an expert?
Clumsy. It shouldn't have been. It's wrong. I can't explain to you, I mean, as he is on. He was expert, or he knew the system, Fujitsu, like no other person, and he was there to assist all parties, prosecution, defence and the court.
Isn't the reality of the position that you either didn't understand what the duties were in relation to the treatment of a person as an expert witness, or you simply didn't care enough to see what those duties were and ensure that they were discharged, and that after the fact you've invented this idea that you were treating Mr. Jenkins as a witness of fact throughout and not an expert, to cover for the fact that you very well know that you complied with none of the duties that you owed to him?
None of what you said is true.
So why...
I don't agree with it.
Why have I been able to find two emails in which you have said, in black and white, that you instructed Mr. Jenkins as an expert, when you say that's exactly what you didn't do?
The reality is, I attended a lot of courses.
Doctor, you can come down, by the way. So you were telling us about courses you attended.
Yeah, I knew at that time what my responsibility duties were.
I'm going to cut out another 10 minutes to 15 minutes of waffle here.
So you say that you've got a witness statement saying that he wasn't an expert. Is that your witness statement?
This is what I'm telling you. This is...
Well, just because you're saying it in a witness statement doesn't mean it's true, does it?
Why not? That's what I believe. That's what I signed up to.
Right. So because you... Okay, got it. So you're saying that because it's in the witness statement you're pointing to on the desk there, it can't be the case that you treated Mr. Jenkins as an expert?
No.
Aren't you just covering up that you complied with none of the duties that you owed as a prosecutor. So you've rewritten history. You said, I didn't treat him as an expert at all. He was a witness of fact throughout. Despite how you described him in these two emails, and despite the fact you attended a conference with counsel with him and chatted through his evidence.
I don't know where you get that we chatted through his evidence.
What did you do? Did you sit there in silence?
I've no recollection of what. I don't know whether you. But there's a attendance note to that.
No, well, that's significant. We haven't had disclosed to us an attendance note of what happened at the October 2010 conference.
As I said to you, that when I left the post office, I didn't take any papers with me. So I can't tell you, I can't assist you any further.
Were you aware at the time of a prosecutor's duties in respect of third-party disclosure or obtaining material from a third party?
But you mean internally or generally how do you mean?
I'm afraid I can't express it any better than that, even if I rearrange the words in the sentence.
I don't know at the moment. I can't tell you what the duties were. Maybe at that time, certainly I would have been. But I mean, to look at it in that much depth and detail now, I don't know. I mean, the answer to that, I don't recall.
Would you agree that when a prosecutor is approaching a third party in order to assist it, the prosecutor, in discharging its disclosure obligations, it should explain to the third party that it is doing so and the importance of the third party conducting inquiries itself that are both recorded and auditable, in order that the prosecutor can then explain to the court what it has and hasn't done to discharge its disclosure obligations?
I can't recall as to whatever you're asking me. Purely at that time, I would have assumed so, because I'd been up to date with a lot of the legislation or a lot of the requirements, but I can't answer to now, moving on, because all the information you provided, and now it's completely different in the sense that I've had the chance to look at it, but even then I have my head is not the prosecution hat on it or head on it, purely trying to assist the best I can the inquiry.
Would you agree that a prosecutor seeking disclosure from a third party should explain to the third party the nature of the duties that both it, the prosecutor, and the third party were under? Give some guidance to it.
I don't know. I don't recall as to what the relationship is here within Fiduciary in partnership. I mean, I'd say I don't got involved in the contractual or commercial side of the business as to how we went about getting information on Fiduciary, and but certainly I years on now, I can't tell you what I knew then or I didn't know at that particular moment in time, so I can't help assist you any more than what I've just said.
Do you agree that this watering down that we see here essentially means that what was advice from counsel to ask a corporation whether it was aware of any other Horizon issue at any other sub-post office has been turned into a rather casual request to an individual that they might mention anything in their witness statement of problems of which Fujitsu was aware?
What it appears to be, but as to what the reality was at that particular moment years ago, I don't know. But certainly from the information you've given me, I can't really give you much depth, detail.
In any event, this didn't, on the face of it, amount to an instruction to Gareth Jenkins as an expert witness in the case, did it?
Well, as you said, that email's not copied to me, so I'm not aware as to Gareth... Well, he's obviously saying Gareth Jenkins should deal with it, but certainly I can't give you any more detail than the fact that I don't know.
I mean, taking a step back, would you agree overall that what we've seen so far is that the post office appears to be proceeding on the basis that it needs some information from Fujitsu in order to disclose its obligations as a prosecutor by way of disclosure. And that has been conflated with a request being made to Mr. Jenkins to provide a response to a defence expert report. That's what it looks like, doesn't it?
Well, it looks that way, but I can't say for sure. It's good. A lot of the time is the information comes, and then you look at it, you review it, and then you flash it out a little bit more. I mean, that's how some of the information is dealt with. But I can't really assist you or the inquiry any further than what's in front of you.
Can we move forward?
That's all it does. It's like the beginning of some sort of song in a nightclub. Jarnail Singh being obstructive or just thick? I'm going to leave it for you to decide. Let me know in the comments section down below.
Dear David, please also get Gareth Jenkins to comment on the enclosed report. That's the third McLachlan report, with a deadline of Monday the 8th of February. So I think you're sending this at 4:30 on a Friday, by the look of it.
I have no idea to what day it was.
Well, if Monday was the 8th...
Well, I'd probably...
The 5th would have been the Friday, wouldn't it? Yes?
I don't know. I mean, if you...
Let's work out.
No, you don't have to work it out. If you say so, it must be a Friday.
I don't want to get to the stage in asking you questions of how a calendar works.
Mr. Singh, no, if you...
You oughtn't to be so suspicious of me that if I tell you that Friday was the 5th...
I'm not suspicious, I'm just saying, yeah, well, years on, I can't tell you the reason why, but certainly I'm trying to get the...
Do you agree that Friday wasn't the 5th?
Yes, I agree.
Excellent.
Fine.
Because Saturday would have been the 6th, wouldn't it?
Must be.
Yeah, and Sunday would have been the 7th?
Yes, agreed.
Good.
Assuming Monday was the...
So you were sending a request at 4:28 on a Friday to Mr. Jenkins saying there's a court deadline for you to respond to this by 4 p.m. on the Monday, weren't you?
Well, that's what the court deadline... I'm stating a fact. I'm not at the... I can only deal with what I have, and I certainly... my habit is that whatever matters in front of you, you deal with as much as you can. I mean, instead of going backwards and forwards. I mean,
going backwards and forwards, we just had to have a discussion about a calendar.
As I said to you earlier, I explained to you what the situation was. There were problems in the background which I wasn't aware of.
You're being made aware here.
Yeah, by
Fujitsu.
David Jones, yes.
That they cannot say, they're not in a position to provide a clear statement as to whether there are problems with Horizon or not.
Yes.
As a prosecutor, does it get any more significant than that?
Well, no. But as I say,
what did you do?
I don't know. I mean, I haven't got the paperwork. I can only go by years on with what you've provided me with. I mean, I can't see what I... This is sort of, again, another 5th of February. I mean, there's been lots of information going backwards and forwards trying to deal with it. So I can't answer that as to... Well, obviously, it's important, and I think we have emphasised it. And then subsequently, finally, I think we do get them, don't we, in March.
I mean, presumably, at the very least, this kind of communication is something that you would want to ensure goes on a disclosure schedule. Just at the very least.
Is it not on the final SCOTUS? Not the one on...
So far as we can see, September, this information was not disclosed.
September 10.
Correct.
That's the final one. That's not on there. Do you know who actually signed that off?
I can check over lunch.
Okay, please do.
But at the... thank you very much. at the very least, you would want to ensure that this would go on a disclosure schedule,
yes,
wouldn't you?
Yes, essential. Yeah, agreed.
Did you say essential?
Of course. Well, yes.
The operators of the system are saying
yeah.
They can't make a statement
because
a clear statement that there are no problems with Horizon.
Yes.
Or known issues with Horizon.
Obviously, there's confusion, there's mistakes, there are all sorts of things going here. But it's a big organisation. How do you control it?
So I wonder whether we could stop there, please. And come back at 10 to 2. We're finishing at 3 p.m. today. And yeah. So I think we can do one session after lunch from 10 to 2 until 3 p.m.
And the next two parts will be coming up soon. Thanks for watching, everybody. This series has done really, really well. Thank you so much.